In accordance with the decision just taken, I now give the floor to Ms. Jayatma Vikramanayake, the Secretary General's Envoy on Youth.
Thank you, Nico. What if I tell you that conflict is good? Conflict isn't bad. In fact, it is good. 25-year-old Mohammed told me as we were sitting inside a temporary shelter in an IDP camp in Baghdad, Iraq. The camp was overpopulated with displaced Iraqis coming from Mosul last August, and everyone had lost their homes, property, education, loved ones during the dreadful journey escaping Daesh. How can someone who lost everything to a conflict say that conflict isn't bad? I asked him in surprise. Mohammed went on. Over time, the term conflict has received a negative connotation. I beg to differ. Having a conflict means that there is diversity, that there are differences of opinions, that status quo is being challenged, all of which are important for the growth of our human civilization. And he goes on, but what truly decides if a conflict is good or bad is the way that we choose to deal with it, the way we choose to resolve it. The decision to use nonviolence over violence, dialogue over arrogance, and compromise over intransigence will decide how conflicts are written in history books. We grew up in an age of unfathomable conflicts and violence and unprecedented forced displacement. If any generation would know the value of peace, that would be us. Therefore, it's our responsibility as a generation to not repeat the mistakes of our past generations. There will always be conflicts, but our generation will choose to resolve them in peace. I couldn't agree more with him. President of the General Assembly, presidents, prime ministers, Secretary General Guterres, distinguished ministers, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. The complex nature of sustaining peace requires us to tap into the potential and creativity of young people, the largest generation in the history of the world. An estimated 408 million young people live in settings affected by armed conflict and violence. Yesterday, I had the privilege to brief the Security Council on youth peace and security. At its heart were discussions on the contributions of young women and men to conflict prevention, humanitarian relief, peace negotiations, and durable peace. There was a resounding call to support young people who work on peace and stability in their communities, often with very little support, funding or visibility, and sometimes under direct threat. I encourage everyone to read the Independent Progress Study on Youth Peace and Security, which contains unfiltered views and aspirations of over 4,000 young people from across the world. It gives us unique insights on how young people see and experience the world we live in, their hopes for peace and security, their demands towards governments and the multilateral system. According to the Progress Study on Youth Peace and Security, and illustrated over and over in my interactions with young people on the ground, there are two key issues we need to immediately address. One, the growing mistrust from young generations towards formal political institutions. Two, the exclusion of young people from meaningfully participating in civic, political, and economic life. Supporting youth participation mechanisms such as youth councils, youth-led organizations, networks, and including young people in electoral processes, political party structures, formal peace processes, and decision-making bodies at local, national, and international levels are key to durable peace. As I always would like to say, meaningful youth participation is prevention. I'm confident that this high-level meeting will emphasize concrete actions that can address the mistrust that young people have so vehemently expressed and the structural injustices they face, which prevents them from realizing their true potential. Ladies and gentlemen, young people for too long have been calling the United Nations to go beyond addressing the immediate needs of war-torn countries to focusing on sustaining peace. We need the United Nations to be proactive, not reactive. This is why we need to build on the Youth Peace and Security Agenda mandated by the Security Council Resolution 2250. The Youth Peace and Security Agenda is at the intersection of Agenda 2030, of the Women, Peace and Security Agenda, of the human rights frameworks, and a core contribution to the prevention of conflict and violence. This agenda was born to ensure that young people are not only called upon when it's time to wave flags, or when their votes are needed, or to go to war, but are listened and taken seriously when they want to shape their present and future. Yesterday, on behalf of young people, I asked the Security Council to further strengthen the Youth Peace and Security Agenda and open up regular discussions on the role of youth in sustaining peace. Today, I issue the same call to you. This General Assembly has representatives of every member state, and with your enormous reach, you can make a huge difference for this generation of young people. And when you do, they will open doors for new future generations to come. Youth-led peace building can benefit from your political, institutional, and most importantly, financial support. This is why I call on you now to ensure youth rights are central to sustaining peace. I have two brief recommendations for consideration at the interactive dialogues today and tomorrow. First, sustainable financing for peace should entail a significant funding increase for the peace-building work led by young people. Earlier, the President of the General Assembly and the Secretary General called for increasing the peace-building fund's resources. Allow me to take this call a step further and invite you to consider that the youth instrument of the Peace Building Fund is adequately financed to offer tangible support to young peace builders on the ground. These young people have a unique ability to access remote communities and marginalized stakeholders. They need accessible funding streams and support to strengthen their organizations. Second, see young people as your partners in the Sustaining Peace Agenda, not as a footnote in your policies or problems to be dealt with. Transforming the United Nations' work on peace building and sustaining peace, in the field especially, requires making sure that the governments and the UN country teams are equipped with the know-how and structures to engage young people as productive and positive actors as they are. Our new approach to peace must ensure that young people are integrated in all sequence stages of the Sustaining Peace Agenda, from planning to implementation, from its review to ensuring durability. When uninformed discussions and mainstream media highlights young people as a threat to peace and security, I have had the unique privilege to meet young peace builders on the ground. I met a youth group in Iraq who are working with young people from diverse backgrounds, religions, and ethnicities to train each other to resolve conflicts through dialogue and negotiation. In Somalia, I met young people who formed an emergency response group to the Mogadishu terror attacks last year. In Colombia, I met with young people who organized the peace camp and who, through silent protest, applied pressure on their government until a new peace deal was reached. Here in the United States, I watched young people march for their lives. This is the potential and commitment young people offer to you as policymakers. We can choose to ignore that call. We can choose to exclude that potential. But that would mean that from 20 years from now, I would still be in your position and would have to listen to another young person calling for youth empowerment, demanding for her rights. And we would still be in the same point on history without moving an inch forward. So please remember, a generation counts on you to make the right decisions. Thank you.